I'm here with John, who's a journalist living in Geneva, who's been covering for a long time different negotiations that are going on here. John, I'd like you to start by telling people who you are and a little bit about yourself.
My name is John Zarocostas, and I'm an independent correspondent based in Geneva for more than 30 years, and I covered all international negotiations from arms control, nuclear weapons, human rights, health, WTO, intellectual property, ITU, the whole spectrum of international multilateral negotiations.
And why are you here at the World Health Organization today?
I'm here tracking the negotiations to conclude an international accord on a pandemic preparedness and response treaty, if it materializes into that, and also to modernize the international health regulations.
John, how would you rate the transparency of this negotiation?
Well, it's a bit different from earlier negotiations. We're not getting around-the-clock daily briefings from the stakeholders, which is normally the case in endgame as negotiations go down the last lap. All the stakeholders brief. There have been some exceptions. Some have briefed more than others. But generally speaking, you don't have that information momentum.
And how about from the WHO?
We get the briefings that Dr. Tedros gives on the weekly briefings, which are informative on that process.
And how do you think the negotiations are going so far, based on what you've been learning as a journalist?
Well, it's a bit hard to read the tea leaves here, because first of all, we're not in the room, and the reporters are not privy to the stakeholder debriefings as well. So we're a bit blindsided in a way.
Do you have access to the text that is produced every day in the negotiation as a journalist?
We get the text that's posted. The rest we have to get from sources.
Do you think it would be in the public interest to have them, share the text more frequently with journalists like yourself?
Well, I think that's helpful to limit misinformation or fake news. Given this is about a pandemic, but of course this is a member-driven process, and as we've known from other negotiations, sometimes it's some members who object to the text being posted in real time.
How do you cover a negotiation? Like I know that you're covering quite a few different things at the same time, so that has to be a challenge for you. But like, pretty much like, for people who are not into journalism on a day-to-day basis, like how do you do your work to cover a treaty negotiation like this?
Well, first of all, you've got to do a lot of homework, absorb the key concepts, so you can't parachute very late in the game. You've got to follow it from the early days, and then as it acquires momentum, hopefully get people on the record as much as possible to shed some light on where the process is going. In this sense, the INB process has been good in at the end of each round they've had a readout of where the talks have been. That's been constructive, but we need more than that.
What would you like to share with the general public about what it's like to work as a journalist in Geneva? Is this a good town to work on as a journalist? I mean, it's a beautiful place, I think Geneva is.
Well, it used to be easier before social media emerged, because I think many negotiators now are apprehensive because of the visibility of social media on much of the process. So some are apprehensive how it will be read in their capitals. So it was easier actually pre social media, as you very well know, because you were here in that time as well.
Wow, I really hadn't thought about that in terms of how it affect whether people would talk to, a traditional journalist like yourself who writes for, more mainstream publications. Which publications are really following this negotiation?
Everyone's following it, but the news cycle, there's so many events happening. The global focus will come on this in the last 3 or 4 days, then you'll get a big impact, a big focus, as it happens in all negotiations. But in the meantime, there's so many other issues happening that media have limited resources to, so they've got to budget where they spend their money and resources.
Mm-hmm. Do you think, on a scale of 1 to 10, how likely it is you think there'll be an agreement by May?
I'm a reporter. I'm here to cover if there's a deal to be continued or no deal. Mm-hmm. I mean, as a reporter, you just cover the beat and report as events materialize. Of course, everyone is hopeful that there will be an accord because everyone lived through the pandemic. This is, as I think the Director General said, it's a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to try and get a deal. But, of course, these are decisions to be made by 194 member states.
Thank you, John. And before I turn off the video, is there anything else you'd like to add to this interview?
No, I was wondering, Jamie, if you have a readout how this will play out.
By our count, there's almost 5,000 brackets in the text as of last night. So to me, I just, it's mind-boggling from my point of view. I just don't know how you get from there to May.
Thanks.